Forgiveness is so powerful, and I really appreciate everything you said, Jen. To me, love is Christian. I'm supposed to love everybody. That means I'm obligated morally to forgive people. So to love everybody is Christian, but to trust everybody is stupid, especially if they've proven themselves untrustworthy already. So you can love. That's love flowing toward them is forgiveness. Reconciliation is when you trust that love flowing back from them is genuine. And that's something that you have to think through before you make the decision to believe that they love you back. The story of Joseph is fantastic.
Yeah.
It's one of the best ever, because you watch that process. Yeah. Joseph is brilliant.
Yeah.
He wants reconciliation with his brothers. He wants the love to flow both ways. But he doesn't just say, oh, guys, it's me, take off his headdress.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
He looks for the fruits of repentance, and he goes through a process. Even though the process is agonizing for him, and it would have been much easier to just throw his brothers in prison, he instead, he keeps having to walk out and sob his guts out. That's because he loves. That's because he already forgave, but he doesn't trust when he hasn't yet seen the fruits of trustworthiness. Anyway, that would be a whole hour. But we're not going to do that. We're talking about how to go through the process of becoming healed, whole, and happy again. And I share this not believing that the only way that you can heal is the gospel. I'm presenting the gospel because this is how I have found healing. I realize there are people all over the world, Buddhists and Hindus and whoever, and God works with them within their framework. And a psychiatrist can also help a person who doesn't have a concept of God. But this is the process that I use in helping people in biblical counseling. The process that I've seen is very effective both in my life and in the lives of people that I counsel with. So I'm sharing with you what I believe is the best way to find healing. The shortcut, the shortest hike across the mountain, is to find something higher than yourself to take refuge in. Everything to me centers on the character of God. Is God really love? Does the universe run on principles of justice and righteousness, mercy and fairness? Does God make everything right in the end? Because if I can believe that, I can deal with any middle. And Satan's first and greatest lie is that God is not love. Ellen White says that he said that the principle of unselfishness doesn't exist. Its very existence he denies. He says God in his heart is selfish. Therefore, there's nothing wrong with me stepping on others. God just made all of us so that he could have little worshipers who would bow before him. You are so great. You are so good. No, God made us because he wanted to pour out love on us. He hopes we love him back, but he doesn't try to make us love him back. That's what abusers try to do. They try to make us do whatever it is that they think will be satisfying to them. And that's why abuse seems to prove Satan's lie about the character of God. We talked earlier about how family dynamics are supposed to teach us about love. But when they don't, and especially when the church doesn't come back in after the family, clean up the mess and say, no, that's not what God is like, this is what God is like, we're left with powerful lies about the way the universe runs. And when I can't believe that there's anybody out there who is going to love me and see my worth, then I start trying to prop up my sense of being loved and valuable by stepping on others. It's what we do. It's what sin is. God is love. His nature, his law is love. It ever has been. It ever will be.
Amen.
For me, this was the foundational thing that gave me the power to believe that life was still worth living. I would look at the sky and go, this can't have just happened. I would look at a leaf and go, this can't have just happened. And because of that, I said, all right, this stuff in the Bible, I'm going to give it a shot. It might be true. And if it is true, then the whole world makes sense. When we can take refuge in the character of God, everything changes. Because only by love is love awakened. I can't love God. This is where we cripple people by saying, you've got to love God anyway. No, only by love is love awakened. So until they can see the love of God reflected in us, in other things, even in the Bible, they cannot love him back. They're crippled in their ability to love because only by love is love awakened. We love because he first loved us. This is the simplest diagram I can give you of the character of God. That God is a triune God, and he seeks the lowest place. Each of the members of the Godhead puts themselves into the middle and goes down to push the others up. I have to put up the picture because I know know 30% of the guys in here have never braided anything in their lives. Sorry, guys. You can braid the other way around, but for the illustration, this is what God is like. God seeks the lowest place, and he puts himself at the bottom to push us up. This is why the universe is safe with God at the head of it, because he is entirely emptied of the thirst for the throne. He uses his throne only to go to the bottom and lift everyone else up. Satan's lie was that God put himself on the throne in order to push everybody down. And this is the central lie of abuse. The abuser puts himself or herself on the throne and pushes everybody down. And God does exactly the opposite. When we come to him and we see this is who he is, we can trust. I don't have to fight for my rights when I know God is fighting for my rights. I don't have to live in rage when I hear stories of abuse. Although the outrage comes, I have to walk it off sometimes. I have to. It's hard. It's hard to hear stories of abuse. It's hard when it hurts people I love. But I can have peace because when I go back and say, okay, God, you are going to make this right. Because you always make it right. There has never been a situation in the history of the universe that you have not been moving toward saying, I'm going to fix this. Therefore, I'm free. I don't have to fix it. I don't have to make the abuse right because God will make it right, and God will do a far better job of making it right than I ever could. That's how we're free to forgive when we take refuge in the character of God. Now, God seeks the lowest place, and when we follow him, we go lower to lift others higher. This is the nature of righteousness. Healing from abuse is critical because abuse wrecks our picture of who God is. It makes it harder for us to love him. Abuse wrecks our picture of who we are, and then we can't love our neighbor as ourselves. And basically, bottom line, abuse makes it harder for us to obey God's law. He said, love me with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Abuse knocks us in the knees and cripples us in our ability to love God and to love others. This is why it's a central end time issue. This is why it's a central gospel issue. Because I cannot love God, I cannot love others, I cannot love myself unless I can believe that somewhere out there, there's a fountain of love that pours to me. I have to know two great things, the two great questions of the human soul. Am I loved and am I valuable? And when I find those in God, I'm free to love in response. I use this simple illustration to help people understand why abuse makes it so hard for them to trust God. Imagine that I've got a sponge up here, right? Nice, dry, hard sponge. You can pick whichever color you like there. I'll have a green one, okay? Just for all the visual people here. So I've got a sponge, and I stick it into this sink full of warm, soapy water. I don't know why it has to be warm and soapy. Cold and greasy would work too, but we won't, right? So I stick it into this sink full of warm, soapy water. What happens when I pull it back out? It should be dripping water, right? It should be soft now. Abuse victims often find that their devotional time is like sinking their sponge into the warm, soapy water, but it comes back up dry. They're like, why? I'm trying. I'm spending time with God. I'm reading the Bible for an hour. I still feel like he's a million miles away and he doesn't care. Because abuse surrounds our hearts with a Ziploc bag. It makes it hard for us to believe that God loves us. So we have to use the sharpest thing in the universe, the sword of the spirit, to cut straight through that. Now, if I'm working in the garden, right? Let's say my garden is hard. We'll use the parable of the sower, okay? The pathway is hard. If I'm wanting to make a garden spot, what do I need in order to take hard ground and make it soft? You can pour water on it, that's the Holy Spirit, but for practical purposes, I need a tiller, I need a hoe, I need something sharp, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna take that sharp thing and I'm gonna do this across the ground, right? I'll make some progress eventually if I do this, but that's not the way we garden, is it? Because we know that's a waste of time. This is how many people have their devotional time. They skitter the Bible across their lives read a few chapters, look at their watch, pray about grandma and their test today, and they don't go deep. In order to cure abuse, you have to point the sharp instrument right at what's actually going on in your heart.
Yes.
I guess it's time to go to bed. So when I point that sharp instrument at the actual struggle going on in my heart, that means, God, I am dealing with fear. I am dealing with rage. I don't understand why you allowed this to happen. Look for stories, for promises, for things that actually apply to what's going on, and that's when you start getting breakthroughs. But sometimes it's still going to be hard. If I take that sharp instrument and I just do this, tap, 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 on that hard ground, is that going to work? I'll make progress. Might even make more progress than if I'm doing this. But ultimately, how do we get that sharp instrument to go into the hard ground?
Pressure.
You got to put some force behind that thing. If you want to get through, sometimes you're going to have to do Jacob's pleading. God, I will not let you go except you bless me. I need to know that you love me. God loves it when we pray like that. It's not dependent on how hard we try. When I reach up to the hand of God, he says, hold on with all you've got in you. But it's not because he wants to make me do it. It's because this is how I grow in strength, right? This is how we work out with the big weights. I hang on with all my strength to the hand of God. And he says, don't worry. When you can't hang on anymore, I'll hang on the rest. You'll never fall when you're hanging on with all of your strength, because he'll make up the difference. But he wants us to grow in our connection with him. So the Ziploc God concept, in order to get your devotional time to get through, sometimes you've got to take one promise or one concept, go through stories in the Bible, and visualize yourself right there, that woman at the well who's been through 5 divorces, all these promises, all these broken heart issues. She's shattered so many times she doesn't even think she can anymore. And now she's living with a guy who doesn't even make a commitment anymore. And Jesus comes to her, put yourself there. And when we see Jesus like that, that's when we puncture the bag and the water of life gets in and we start not being thirsty anymore. That's what God wants to do. The Ziploc God concept is simple, but I find when you use simple things with people that they can visualize, sometimes it breaks through like nothing else could. The gospel is simple, immeasurably deep, but so simple. Emotional brokenness destroys our relationships with God and others. We break with God, and then it starts bleeding out into our other relationships. Think of it like a sweater. Anybody here ever sniffed a sweater? What happens when you cut through that yarn? It starts unraveling everything else. When we snip with God, all our other relationships start unraveling. But this is the beauty of the gospel. God is relational. And so when righteousness flows in, when we connect again with God, he starts reversing that and bringing the sweater back together. Because that's who he is. That's what he does. That's what relationship is. Most of our brokenness is relational. If you look back on your life, think for just a minute. What are the most cataclysmic, painful events in your life? Think of 1, 2. Chances are they're relational. It's not that broken leg that you broke skiing. It's that broken relationship. Most of our most significant brokenness is relational. Because the law of God is all about relationships, sin is all about relationships. And that's great news, because righteousness is then also all about relationships. Righteousness is the healing of sin. All of sin is about breaking relationship. All of righteousness is about restoring relationship. We restore with God, and then it starts bleeding out into healing everywhere else. So, that's great news for us. Tim Clinton says we were wounded in relationships and we are healed in them too. We won't make much progress on our own. And right there is where some of the victims go, oh no, because how am I going to find safe, healthy people? It's hard, I'll admit. It's hard not only to find people who are safe, because all of us are sinners, so in some way, none of us is safe. But at the same time, it's hard because we don't want to believe that these people are safe, just in case they aren't. For abuse victims, relationships become walking on the pond. thin ice. Everywhere I go, what if this is the one? If it starts creaking, we leap. This is why we need to have a connection with God that gives us the strength and the faith that we can know if this relationship with this sinner falls apart, either because of my sin or the other person's sin, the good news is God will catch me. Like a rock climber who's got a rope and it's anchored solid at the top and you're tied onto it thoroughly. When you're coming up that cliff and you're connected, and not to oversimplify it, but I don't want to go into all the dynamics of rock climbing for those who don't do it. But if you're tied on really solidly to that rock and to that rope, and you're climbing and you fall, you may get scraped up. Ropes bounce a little bit. You may get scraped up a little bit on the way down, but you won't die. You won't fall all the way to the bottom. You'll fall 5 feet, you get scratched a little bit because broken relationships hurt. But it won't destroy you because that rope is there. God is enough. So the first thing we need is security in our connection with God. And that will help us to be able to brave risking getting hurt in relationships with other sinners. Because sinners break relational law. That's what we do. That's what sin is. But God will heal us and he'll give us the strength to trust. No, you can't trust everybody. You try to, you're stupid. But at the same time, we need to trust somebody. Because this is how we bring healing to others. If I wall myself off so I don't hurt anybody, I'm going to end up getting really thirsty inside there. And finally, I'm just going to break through the wall and grab whoever's going past. And that's probably not your smartest way to find people to trust. Here's a central thing that abuse victims need to understand. Pain is not our primary enemy. Sin is our enemy. That's selfishness. Selfishness and self-centeredness manifest in all kinds of ways. They may manifest in grandiosity, me thinking I'm better than everybody else. They may manifest in severe depression, because depression still leads us to be completely self-centered, right? If I think I'm the greatest person in the world, or if I think I'm the worst person in the world, both of them will end up making me fundamentally self-centered. Pain is a tool God can use to transform us into his image. There's a fantastic book called The Gift of Pain that I highly recommend for anybody who wants to explore this concept more. God wants to use pain to help us learn to hate and overcome sin. This is the whole war between Christ and Satan in a nutshell. God said to Lucifer, don't do it, don't do it. And he did it anyway. And God said to Adam and Eve, don't do it, don't do it. They did it anyway. God said to our abusers, don't do it, don't do it. They did it anyway. And God says, not only in spite of sin, but actually because of sin, the universe is going to understand love in ways they never could have if sin had never happened. And to those who have been abused, I say the same. God wants to use these things that were never his will to accomplish his greater purpose of revealing his character to us and ending up helping us at the end to understand love in ways we never could have if we hadn't been through these things. And even if we were the abusers, God wants to deliver us and help us to learn to hate sin in ways we never could have if we had not been trapped in it. That is the purpose of sin. That's why the tree was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It wasn't just the tree of the knowledge of evil. Anybody ever wondered about that? Why wasn't it just straight up the tree of the knowledge of evil? Because it was. But it's also the knowledge of good, because God knew that this was the way to inoculate the universe. That once we have seen how the opposite of love works, we will never let it come back. And if anybody ever 20 million years from now down the road says, I've got an idea, I'd like to try selfishness, the rest of the universe will say, you are out. We don't want that. We've already tried it. It doesn't work. God wants to bring us to the point where we ourselves grasp that love is the best way to run the universe. And we do that often when we have seen the nature of evil in all its fullness. So God uses pain to help us learn to hate sin and to turn away from it in disgust. See, a faith struggle when you haven't been through some of these pains can be kind of like going up a slight hill. It's, you know, you're jogging uphill, it's a little harder, but it doesn't overwhelm you. The faith struggle for those who have suffered abuse is often more like this. It's grappling hand to hand with evil, feeling like I can't believe that God is love when I have all these things roaring through my mind, but we can't. not because we are fountains of faith and belief, because having faith is a miracle. If I can manufacture faith, I can overcome sin all by myself, because all sin starts with unbelief. It starts with a cycle of unbelief and pride. The moment I question whether God is really love, if he's really who he says he is, I will also start exalting myself to be like the Most High, right? I want to be able to sit in judgment and say, God, if I were you, I would handle this better than you do. And what's more prideful than that? So all sin starts with unbelief and pride. It's a cycle. From Lucifer to Adam and Eve onward, every sin has started with unbelief and pride. And that means that the reversal is faith and humility. And this is how God reverses the damage of sin in our hearts. But faith has to be a supernatural act, because we can't manufacture the cure for sin in ourselves. So God gives us the faith we need as we reach for him. He reaches for us and says, I was already here. I've been drawing you with my arms of love. I've been calling to your heart. And what you're experiencing, these symptoms, these pains, are not the evidence that you are hopeless, that no one loves you. They're the cry of God to your heart saying, come away to me. Let me satisfy you. Let me help you love like you could never have imagined. And once we've been through abuse and darkness, we appreciate the light more than we ever could have if we had been in the darkness. Just like the people who were blind when Jesus healed them. Those people, I think, appreciated seeing more than you and I ever do. Right? Mm-hmm. Because they had been blind and now they can see. They saw with new eyes. That's what God wants us to do. Because of the hard work that abusers or survivors of abuse have to do to thrive, they have potential for becoming the most effective advocates, educators, and defenders. We've been lost in that dark maze underground, wandering, trying to find our way out. We've heard the voice of Jesus, we've listened to it, and we've walked. And every time we came to a why, we said, God, which way do I go? What do I do? And he shined a light. He's called us. He's shown us how to get out of the maze. When we finally get out of the maze, and I don't mean that there's ever an event that I'm now healed, but when we come to the end where it makes sense and we're out and we're trusting God and we're living in the light, he says, go back and get that one. Because you know your way around the maze. You can find your way. And this is the beauty of having survived. God wants to use us to be those who help others to heal. We can put our finger on the pulse of something in ways that somebody else can't. We can say, it sounds to me like you're experiencing this. Sometimes we have our own triggers. Sometimes it's just plain really hard to go back into that maze. But this is what God wants, because this is what redemption is. God calling people out of darkness into light. And when we experience it, the first thing we think is, oh man, I don't want anybody else to have to live there either. It's beautiful, this work of delivering others. This kind of Japanese artwork is called kintsugi. If there are any Japanese people here, correct me if I'm saying it wrong. But I want to be clear, God doesn't cause abuse. An enemy has done this, is the declaration. But God does a phenomenal job of bringing good out of evil. God's will and God's purpose are two different things. God has an ideal will, stuff that he would like us to do. When we're hiking across that mountain, he says, here's the best path. The GPS says, go this way. But we go, I got this. And we take a detour. And he'll keep on saying, recalculating, go back that way. But at some point, he says, all right, then keep going. This may be a lot rockier than what you wanted. This may be a lot steeper than what I had in mind for you, but it will still be beautiful. And there will be flowers that you discover and vistas that you see that you never would have experienced if you hadn't taken this path. God wants to use even the things that were not his will to accomplish his greater purpose, because his greater purpose is, first of all, to reveal to us that love is the best way to run the universe. And every person's actions do ultimately accomplish proving that purpose. Even Hitler did a good job of showing the rest of the universe that sin is a bad idea. Not a good way to run the universe. We don't really want this on the throne. So Hitler accomplished God's purpose while going directly against his will. Our abusers accomplished God's purpose while going directly against his will if we respond in surrender. If we respond in faith, going, that is who God is. I will not become like this. I will become like this. in that way, abuse is a central end time issue because it drives us toward the character of God. The crisis that we go through at the end of time is characterized by abuse. There will be death, there will be torture, there will be all kinds of terrible things going on in the last days before Jesus comes. But these things will only make us go, I long for a better land. That's where I belong, and I will not become like this. I will become like that. The harder we hang on to the hand of God, the more the pressure just presses us faster, closer to Him. We don't decide how much pressure is on us. Sometimes other people's choices push us down paths that we didn't choose. But we decide which direction the pressure pushes us. And the more pressure that we experience, the faster we grow close to Jesus, the faster the refiner's fire changes us. The suffering involved in abuse can form the basis of a gift of empathy for those others who have suffered. God makes us beautiful and effective in reaching out to others. He wants to show His love through us. Empathy calls us to experience the joy and pain of others selflessly. We can be happy with those who are happy. We can weep with those who weep. Others are happy, be happy with them. And when they're sad, be sad. Sometimes the most healing thing we can do is come alongside somebody and grieve with them, giving them permission to feel. When I was 23 or 24 when I first went to counseling. And I went angrily the whole way. Here was what happened. I started feeling like I can't live this way. I can't keep on the anxiety, the everything. It's awful. And so finally I came to the point where I prayed, okay, God, I don't want to go to counselor and I'm not going to counselor. But if you want me to go to counselor, then you make the appointment and you get me there. I will not exert a particle of energy to make this happen. And a couple of days later, my roommate said, you know, Nicole, there's this really nice guy who does counseling. Would you be willing to go if I made the appointment and I drove you there? That was not my response. But I went. I went, and you know, I don't even remember much of what he said. He was a retired pastor. I remember the look on his face. I remember that he looked like I was hurting. And I was astounded. I told him my story. I started sobbing when I said, you know, here are all the things that my dad did to me. These are the things that my mom did. Here's what my grandfather did. And as I'm going through all these things and I started sobbing, he said these magical words. He said, you have been hurt so much. He gave me permission to feel. All those years I had been telling myself the words that I was told over and over. You're just making a big deal out of nothing.
Get over it.
Get over it. Exactly. Come on, what's wrong with you?
There are others who suffer more.
Exactly. Words that I had gone over and over in my mind. Come on, everybody else goes through so much more. Stop making such a big deal. Stop whining. But he gave me permission to feel and to grieve and to heal and to move forward. Sometimes the best thing you can do is not anything you say. It's the fact that you come alongside a person and you image God. Show them this is what God is like. Not like that, like this. He hurts. He cares. You see, Jesus couldn't stop every bad thing from happening because otherwise sin would have gone on forever. So instead he said, I'm going to come down there and I'm going to go through it with you, Nicole. I'm going to go through everything that you go through. And Jesus was raped with me. Jesus was beaten with me. And Jesus was called names like me so that I would never go through it alone. And when I grasped that, wow, why did you do that? Why would you do that? He said, you have no idea how much I love you. And that was what was healing. Come alongside a person in their grief. Let them know it's okay to feel. You can never imagine the power of demonstrating the character of God to other people. Without empathy, we cannot feel others' love for us, nor experience an internalized impact of the cross. Without empathy, we nullify the power of the gospel to transform our hearts. Pain is God's most effective tool to teach us empathy. When you have suffered, you start understanding what other people are suffering. Pain is also God's most effective tool to teach us hatred of sin. If it weren't for pain, sin would go on throughout eternity. we'd never stop. Because if God said, okay, Satan, you can do some bad stuff, but no famines, please, that's too much. No rapes, please, that's more than anybody can handle. Sin would go on through all of eternity because nobody would actually ever come to the point where we went, no, just no. This is bad. So pain is the cure that God is using to help deliver us from sin. And as we continue letting pain do what it's supposed to do in us, not only does it change us into who we're called to be, but it turns us into change makers to help others become who God is calling them to be. And this is what God wants to do to finish the work in this world. When his character is perfectly reproduced in his people, he will come to take us home with him. That's not me becoming perfect. That is God's people learning to love him and to love each other.
So we have a couple minutes if there's a couple questions, and then we should
yes.
break for at least half an hour so we can start again at 2. So a couple questions?
I do just want to say one thing. If you need comfort for the credit, I have the sheets. So if I'm fine,
thank you.
Yeah, I just want to say I really appreciate your talk. I really love what you have to say. The other thing is, I know that you said something about only by love is love awakened. As a youth pastor, especially in my past, I've had an issue with coming up with a good explanation as to some of the actions of God when it comes to the Old Testament, especially with allowing the Israelites to go and kill children. And so a lot of my youth had come up and questioned, does God exist or does God really love, when there's issues like that that seem unresolved, or at least I haven't been able to come up with a good answer.
Yeah, that's a great question, and that could be an
yeah.
hour too. But
here's
my answer. No, it's very important because this is a snag that stops the flow of people being able to love God. My answer is simple. When God evaluates a situation, he has to do what is best to bring the maximum number of people to redemption. So in every situation, he has to go, what is the best to bring the maximum number of people to redemption? In Sodom, for example, he knows if they go in, if Lot goes and rescues all the kids and hauls them out, how is that going to work out? How are they going to rescue all the kids of the Canaanites? Remember, some of these kids are being raised to be sacrificed. How do you treat your kid when you're raising them so that you can sacrifice them? So these kids are growing up with reactive attachment disorder issues. They're growing up beaten and abused. And for the Israelites to take them in, not having any concept of how to deal with some of these issues, never mind the fact that some of these kids are going to live for the rest of their lives with such profound inability to believe in the character of God that they're going to suffer so much that I think some of them, God was like, you know, this one's still innocent right now. If they're snuffed out now, they might still be able to be in heaven. Or maybe they'll just be as they never were. But for the Israelites to adopt them all would have been cataclysmic. It would have ruined what God was trying to do. And so God tries to do what's redemptive in every situation to the best of his ability. Does that make sense? We can talk more about it later. Bye.
Just real quick on what you just said, one of the most beautiful things I read when I was like 19 years old, I think it's in the book Early Writings, where Ellen White has this vision and she sees all of these babies and children whose parents aren't there and the angels are raising them in the new earth.
Yes.
So think of the flood, think of Sodom. You know what I mean?
Yes.
There's all these children who are just in the new heavens and the new earth,
yes.
and the parents aren't there.
Parents aren't there.
Their lives ended didn't mean their eternal lives ended.
Right. I love the millennium. This is one of my favorite doctrines because there is stuff that's just not going to make sense until we get there. And God says, trust me on this, and when we get there, we'll have 1,000 years, and I will sit down with you and answer every question you have. And it's only at the end of that 1,000 years that God says, does everybody vote that what we've done is good? And everybody says, we agree. He says, do you believe that I still need to destroy your sons and your grandmothers and people who were committed to evil in such a way that I couldn't save them? And everybody says, yes, it needs to be done. Only then does God resolve things permanently. So for sometimes the best answer you can give is to say, there are questions we can't understand fully, and God has said, ask all of the questions then, because I'm going to give you answers that make sense.
Who a lot of the stuff in the Old Testament is so hard to conceive of because of the context in which it happened. A lot of the laws, they look archaic and abusive to us, but if you go into the culture at the time, with books like Is God a Moral Monster, David's book on the Old Testament, Richard Davidson, you realize that God did the very best thing for that context.
The Odyssey of Love is great for unpacking some of this,
really
too.
Good.
This is related to the forgiveness presentation. I just wanted to share something that Jesus said that really helped me. I went through a time where I was in a deep struggle to forgive. And I think I had processed forgiveness from like a model of deprivation. It's just something that you're supposed to do. Like, why haven't you done it already? And God brought me to a focus on the specific restitution that will take place on the other side of eternity. And I think, you know, if you watch TV, like, how do parents respond, you know, after the abduction of their children and they're reunited? How there's this outpouring of, like, finally I'm reconnected to them and I get to, you know, anything I can do to help make this up to them, I'm going to do it. And there's a statement where Ellen White says that for all the world neglects to bestow, that God himself will make up to us in the best of favors. And what's that Russian guy's name? Dostoevsky, he says, I believe like a small child that all suffering and evil will be made up for. And that in the end, after the grand finale, that there's this moment of eternal harmony that's enough. And so I started believing that God had this specific restitution package for me that is going to be specifically healing in the ways that I need. And then forgiveness became an act of faith and me saying, I want that.
Beautiful.
And then it just shifted the way I thought about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, that's so powerful. Man, I wish you had an hour to talk about that too.
Beautiful, that's really helpful.
Yes.
Okay, so say that there's a situation where you're struggling with understanding forgiveness and you want to understand the situation where abuse happened and that abuser is actively in your life, but there's no, you can see that there's maybe remorse from the abuser, but the abuser himself hasn't addressed the situation. And the abuser is still in your life, and the situation is addressed. Is applied forgiveness something that's necessary to go part of healing? Because if you can forgive someone, like if you do it on your own, but it's evident that it needs to be aired out or it needs to be addressed, is applied forgiveness, how do you truly forgive?
Is the person being confronted with what they did? No.
I don't know.
Because sometimes, depending on the situation, it's really good to have a counselor involved in the decision-making process, or at least a mentor or something, or maybe even two or three people. But sometimes it's appropriate to confront. And having to confront someone doesn't necessarily totally preclude them experiencing true repentance. It is better if the Holy Spirit can get through to them without you, but there's sometimes God uses human beings. And so it may be something you may want to consider.
Sometimes the abuser needs to be coached through the process of learning how to confess. They know they should, they don't know how, they don't know where to start. You send them an email and say, these are the things you should do. Sending that email is an act of trust because they might just twist everything you said and, you know, use it against you. But still, it's often worth trying if you come from a place of strength.
I mean, look at David. No, that's okay. Look at David. We've talked over each other all the time. He's good. David, you know, Nathan came to David, pointed his hand and raised his right hand to heaven and his left. I think he pointed his left and said, thou art the man. It's a very powerful, very direct confrontation. And it did bring David to repentance. And it was real repentance. But he was in a fog before that. So sometimes people need, you know, a direct confrontation.
Sometimes all you can do is flow the forgiveness toward them. Don't expect reconciliation back. Don't expect them to flow back apologies or confessions towards you. Because sometimes they can't or they won't. But at the same time, appropriate whenever possible to try to help bring them to repentance, because often that could be the thing that helps them come to Jesus, and that's redemptive gospel work.
Do you think it's appropriate to go to someone and say, you did this and I already forgiven you, but I need you to know that you did this and this is how it affected me, and I love you and forgive you?
Depending on the nature of the violation, is it sometimes appropriate? You said that, you know, the person is still in your life, but they haven't. Is it appropriate at any point to say there's not sufficient evidence of change or repentance, you're still in my life, so I'm going to remove myself or remove you from my life?
That's absolutely a Matthew 18 principle. Matthew 18 is where you go to your offender between you and them alone. That's, you skip that in abuse when there's no question. You know, that's more for did you really say that thing about me kind of stuff. You know, the principle is to keep it to the smallest group of people possible who can deal with it, because that's most likely to bring them to repentance. If they're being shamed in front of everybody, they're going to minimize what they did, more likely than if you're doing it alone and an act of love. But with an abuse situation, particularly escalated levels of abuse, you skip that altogether. You know, just go to the arrest. But at some point, you know, when you make it bigger, the biggest circle that's dealt with there is the church, and says, let him be to you as a heathen and a publican. That's not being nasty in how Jesus treated heathen and publicans. He was loving toward them, but it's shutting them out and the church standing against them like a wall and saying, you are not right with God, and we are not going to pretend like you are. We're going to shield the victims, and we're going to stand up against you. That is an act of love every bit as much as the perpetrators.
And what Ty said is does work in some situations, but I think in many situations, the person, we owe it to the person to follow the due process that Jesus laid out in Matthew 18. I don't know the specifics here, but there may be something more you could do in terms of rebuke or confrontation or accountability that could change, could be a game changer in mind. It'd be worth entertaining before you opt out.
Okay, I have for each of you, if it's possible. The question for you is, I have seen a lot of, sometimes empathy, it's not good for the victim. In the case that it's too much empathy, too much,
that's
you
right.
know, too much of, oh, you know, like poor, and there's not the enough, like how to help her to move from there.
That's
so is there any limit?
Evaluate every situation. When you see, remember the principle, God moves people toward what's most likely to bring to repentance and healing. So if you see this is starting to get the person to go, actually, I don't need to keep moving toward becoming better through this, well then, you need to adjust. So move toward what's actually healing and helpful. And in general, when you don't know for sure, send them to a professional counselor who can help with that process.
Thank you.